Hello people, welcome to Gurukula. I'm Jai. So this is the second part of the video for deriving the two-ray propagation model. If you have landed up directly to this particular video, I will give you the part one link on the top right corner. You can check out the part one video first and then you can resume to this particular video for better understanding. So now, if you are not yet subscribed to the channel, please do consider subscribing the channel. And now we will let us get into the topic, two-ray propagation model. So in our previous video, we just formulated a basic setup for a two-ray ground reflection model, and then we made certain assumptions to validate the two-ray propagation model, and finally we just found out the different terms. So we just found out what will be the E total, the total E field received at the receiver side, which has two terms in it. One is E field for the line of sight signal and another one is E field for the reflected wave signal. So the first term represents the E field for line of sight and second term represents the E field for the reflected signal, and the minus comes in between these two terms. That is because of the reflection coefficient, and by the loss of reflection from dielectric, the reflection coefficient will be given as minus 1. So that is the reason why we got minus over here. And then by using the method of imaging, we just computed the path difference in terms of HT, HR and then D, so that it is the approximated value is 2 times HT, HR divided by D. And later on we found out what is the phase difference as well, so that is given by omega C times del divided by C. And time difference also we have calculated, and time difference I'm not going to use very much in this particular derivation, but still it is important to make a note of this particular equation, which will be very much helpful for us in solving the problems related to two-ray propagation model. So with this, let us further get into certain assumptions, and we will try to formulate the path loss for two-ray propagation model. So now we will make an assumption that when D becomes larger, so when the distance between transmitter and then the receiver is getting large and large, then what it happens is the difference between the distances D prime and then D double prime becomes very small, which means of course it can become negligible part. So what happens is the entire equation, this particular entire equation, this represents the amplitude part and this represents the phase part, similarly for the reflected wave as well. So what happens is the difference between this D prime and then this D double prime goes very very lesser, so that I can approximate the equation like this. So E naught D naught divided by D is equals to magnitude of E naught D naught divided by D prime is equals to magnitude of E naught D naught divided by D double prime. So what will happen is my signal is not going to vary much on the amplitude, but it is going to vary only in terms of phase, which means this particular E naught D naught divided by D prime is equals to E naught D naught divided by D double prime, so that I can use both these particular terms as one single term, that is E naught D naught divided by D, and my signal is going to vary only based on the phase part. So that is the meaning for this particular approximation. So making this approximation, and as well as trying to find out the E field at a particular time, I will say that T is given by D double prime divided by C. Then my equation can be written as E total with respect to D, and as well as T is equals to D double prime by C, just by replacing the T with D double prime by C. Wherever I have T, I have replaced that with D double prime divided by C. So you could see that this same equation has been rewritten with T as D double prime divided by C. And as well as we have already made an approximation to this, when the D gets larger and larger, the difference between D prime and then D double prime becomes unnoticed, which means it becomes almost equal. So I can conclude that I can approximate this E naught D naught divided by D prime as one single common term. This is based on this particular approximation. And you could see that this particular term, so this term D double dash minus D dash divided by C. So D double dash minus D dash, I can consider that as del. So that is the path difference. So the path difference can be represented as del. So I have replaced this D double prime and then D prime as del over here. Remaining things omega C will be carry forwarded, and then the denominator C will be carry forwarded. So this is all about this particular term. And coming to this particular term, this will get cancelled out because D double prime minus D double prime becomes 0. So that will be resulting to cos 0. And also, I can rewrite this equation to the form theta del. So I can always rewrite this particular form as theta del, because omega c del divided by c can be rewritten as theta del, so which is nothing but the phase difference. So phase difference omega c del divided by c can be written as theta del, so that is what replaced over here. So with this equation in hand, we can come to a generalized solution, or we have to approximate this particular equation, and for which I will take the help of trigonometric identities. So when you look at this particular equation, this equation is almost equal, or it is very similar to this particular cos function. So cos of omega ct minus cos of omega ct plus theta del can be written as 2 times sine of theta del divided by 2 sine of omega ct plus theta del divided by 2. So this is from the trigonometric identity what we have. So by considering this particular trigonometric identity, I can resolve down this equation to a form like this. So E total can be given as 2 times of E naught D naught divided by T sine of 1 by 2 omega C del divided by C. So this term, this particular cos term is converted to sine term by using this trigonometric function. So when I replace the values of this omega c and then del, I can rewrite the equation like this. So 2 becomes 2, e naught d naught divided by d is carry forwarded, sine of 1 by 2 is written as such, the denominator c is written as 1 by c. I have replaced omega c with 2 pi f, and then the del, the approximated value for the del, that is path difference, is 2 ht hr divided by d. So when I simplify this particular equation, I will end up to the final form like this. So 2 times of E naught D naught divided by D sine of 2 pi H T H R divided by lambda D. So this will be the total E field which I will receive at the receiver side after making several assumptions and then approximations. This will be the final E field which I will get at the receiver side. So important thing to note at this particular point is the total E field is getting decayed in an oscillatory fashion. Your signal is going to get decayed in term as an oscillatory fashion. So which will be difficult for us to formulate a path loss model if we have an oscillating function over here, so that we have to make another assumption at this point. So what I will do is I can make another assumption over here. So by using the identity, sine theta can be written as theta itself, for which when theta is very very lesser than 0.3 radians. So when my theta is lesser than 0.3 radians, I can write sine theta as theta itself. So by making this assumption, my final equation will take the form E total is equals to 2 times of E naught D naught divided by D. So the same term appears as such. As you could notice that I have eliminated the sine term by using this particular identity over here. So for further continuing, just by rewriting the terms, I will get the final E total equation as E naught D naught times 4 pi H T H R divided by lambda D whole squared. So now, so far, by this particular time, we have represent the E field only in terms of E field. So it is mandatory to represent the E field in terms of power so as to calculate the path loss. So we will try to represent this E field, the total received E field at the receiver side, in terms of power by using a very simple relation, that field square is equals to power. So power can be easily represented by using E field. If I take the square of the field, then I will get the power. So the power density of at the received signal. So what will be the total power that I will receive at the receiver side? PR can be represented by the formula E total squared times AE, where E total squared is nothing but the power density of the transmitted signal. So the very basic formula for PR is power density times effective aperture. AE is nothing but the effective aperture. The formula for all these effective aperture and the basic PR formula is already discussed in the free space propagation model. You can check out the video in the playlist. So when I square it out, we have the value for E total. So when this is the value for E total, and then when I square it up, I will get the power. I will get the equation in terms of power. So we know that the formula for effective aperture is GR times lambda square divided by 4 pi. And so this squaring E field is nothing but the total power transmitted, effective isotropic radiated power. So that can be written as PTGT times 4 pi squared HTHR the whole squared divided by lambda D squared. So this is what the final equation which I will get after replacing the E field to the power term. So just by simplifying the terms and then by cancelling out all the factors, my the simplified version of this particular equation becomes, so PR is equals to PTGTGR times HTHR the whole squared divided by D power 4. So this will be the final received power at the receiver side for the two-ray propagation model. So one thing which I have to notice over here is the denominator factor is D power 4. The denomination factor is D power 4. And this represents that the received power will be degrading in a scale of d power 4. But whereas in the free space propagation model, in the receiver side, at the denominator side, we had d squared. So the signal is going to get degraded at a square of distance between transmitter and then the receiving antenna. But here for the two-ray propagation model, the received power is going to degrade at a d power 4 rate. So having this equation in hand, so PR is equals to PT times GTGR. So this is the received power at the receiver side. So we can easily calculate what will be the path loss. So the formula for path loss is PT divided by PR. We already have PR on the left hand side. And just by dragging that PT on the right hand side to the left hand side, I will end up with the equation like this. So PR divided by PR. I just brought this PT to the left hand side. So PR divided by PT is equals to GTGR times HTHR the whole squared over D power 4. And we know that the path loss is given by PT by PR. So just by simply reciprocating the equation, I will get so D power 4 over GTGR times HTHR the whole squared. So as we all know that this will be represented in difference in units. So in order to represent the entire equation, the path loss will always be represented in dB gain, so that the dB gain is represented by taking 10 log. So path loss model for two-ray propagation is given by, so 40 log of 10 minus of 10 log of GT plus 10 log of GR plus 20 log of HT plus 20 log of HR. So this will be the total path loss for two-ray propagation model. So that is what the final path loss model equation for two-ray propagation model. So just to summarize, what are all the equations that we have seen combining both part 1 video and as well as part 2 video. We started off with defining the basic or the general equation for the E field. And we just derived what will be the E field for line of sight signal, and then we derived what will be the line of sight signal, what will be the E field for the reflected wave as well. So where the line of sight signal travels a distance D prime and the reflected wave travels a distance D double prime. And then we know that the total signal received at the receiver side can be given as the sum of E line of sight signal and as well as the reflected signal. So when we substitute all these things and after final modifications, we got the final equations like this. So we have found out the total E field received at the receiver side. And then we found out what will be the path difference. What will be the path difference? For finding out the path difference, we just incorporated the method of imaging technique, and we just formulated what is D prime, and then we formulated what is D double prime, and after several approximation by using Taylor series approximation, we have approximated the path difference del can be given by 2 times HTHR divided by D, and we just formulated the path difference theta del, and we just formulated the time difference which can be given by theta del divided by 2 pi f. And further on, after calculating all these values, we just proceeded to make certain assumptions, and then we just approximated. When the D becomes larger and larger, then the difference between D prime and D double prime becomes unnoticed, so that I can write D prime and as well as D double prime as D itself, so that there will not be any maximum change, any considerable change in the amplitude because of amplitude. So the signal is going to get vary only because of the phase part. So the final E total can be written as this particular form. So E naught D naught times 4 pi HTHR over lambda D squared. And later on, we just represented this particular E field in terms of power. So just by squaring the E field, we will get the power. So simple relation is what given over here. And we represented the received power like this. So PR is equals to PT GT GR times HT HR the whole square divided by D power 4. And the main thing what we observed here in this particular equation is the received power is going to get decayed at the rate of D power 4, where D is the distance between transmitter and then the receiving antenna. And finally, the path loss for a two-ray model is given by the equation. So 40 log of D minus of 10 log of GT, 10 log of GR plus 20 log of HT plus 20 log of HR. So this will be the final equation for two-ray path loss model. So that's all about this particular video. So this video, both part 1 and part 2, summarizes the two-ray propagation model. Well, so see you in the next video. Until then, happy learning.